The Voice of the Rain by Walt Whitman. So here it's a rain which has been personified. That's how the poem has been entitled as The Voice of the Rain. So here it's a rain which is expressing its own journey of life, which is expressing or explaining its own life cycle. And through the life cycle of rain, we'll be able to make out like the rain is somewhat like human being. The life of rain is somewhat like human being. If we talk about human being, what are the most intrinsic qualities of human life? Can anyone make out? What are the most intrinsic values of human life? What are the most intrinsic qualities of human life? They are love, bond, or you can say simply the bond of love. Secondly, relationships. Love, relationships, and third, reunion. Reunion. Okay, when you love somebody, when you have got relationships with you, your parents, your family, your siblings, whatever the relation, the friends. So relationships are the intrinsic part of human life. So when relationships are there, love will automatically be there. So love, relationship, and reunion. It's not that we are always together, always. It's not that we are always together at one time. Okay? So when children grow up, they have to go out of station, sometimes out of the country, but sooner or later they come back and get reunited with their family. So that is what the family life, or that is what human life is about. And the rain describes its life cycle, and will come to know that its life cycle is somewhat the same. Okay, it gets birth from and its source of origin is, its source of birth is the earth itself. Earth is the mother of rain, and so earth gives life to rain. Then what rain gives to earth, it also gives life to rain, earth. If earth gives life to rain, then rain also gives it back the same what it had got from it. So when I was talking about what are the intrinsic qualities of human life, one more thing we can add there, like relationships, love, reunion. And another thing was giving back what we get from others. Life is not just about getting and getting and getting from others. It's also about repaying. If parents give us birth, if parents do so many things for us, in the end, we also have to return them the same lease of life what we had got from them. So that lease of life we can give to our parents when they need us, when they become old. Okay, so giving a new ray of life, giving a new lease of life to the parents when they become old, when they need us the most. That is what human life is about. So even nature does it. So nature is the biggest inspiration to the humanity. Okay, through the life cycle of rain, we get the value of love, reunion, bonding, and above all, giving back what we have got. Okay, so it's all about reciprocation. If we get something, we must know how to give back also. That's how the life cycle goes on smoothly. So the nature also teaches us the same thing, what human being should do in life. So the voice of the rain, here the rain has been personified, and the rain describes its life cycle. And that life cycle, the poet says, is perennial, that is permanent. The life cycle of rain never gets disrupted. It's not that this year the life cycle of rain will be going on and next year the rain will say, now I want to take rest, I will not go. It's not so. The life cycle of rain goes on and on and on and on without being seen. You may see this, you may not see this. You may observe it or you may not observe it. Nature goes on and on with its life cycle. Nature keeps on doing its own work. Okay, nature is always on its toes. So the poet in the very beginning says, "And who art thou?" Said I to the soft falling shower. What is soft falling shower? It's a light rain. Light rain, not very, not like a very heavy, you know. It's just simply the simple rain, light rain, which is pleasant. So the poet asks that light rain, like, who you are. The poet wants to know the identity of rain. And very strangely, very unexpectedly, he gets an answer from rain. And the poet says that I'm going to translate it. So here, translation doesn't mean that the rain spoke in French or in German, and the poet is going to tell us the same thing in English. Here, the translation actually is an interpretation. Okay. So what, when rain was falling with its pitter and patter sound, the poet, with his poetic sensibility, is able to make out like what the rain might have been speaking about. So here, translation is the interpretation of poetic sensibility of the poet. Okay, the poet is giving an interpretation to what the rain might have said. So it is the poetic sensibility which makes poet understand the language of the rain. I am the poem of the earth, said the voice of the rain. So the rain said that it's a poem of the earth. So poem is what? Poem is made up of rhyme, rhythm. It has got a certain set pattern. It has got so many beautiful words. A poem is not a poem if it doesn't have words, thoughts, or rhyme and rhythm and meter. So the poem, which is made up of rhyme, rhythm, meter, beautiful thoughts, words. So in the same way, the poem, the rain said, like, I am the poem of the earth, because even the rain is made up of so many elements. It is made up of small droplets. It is made up of small vapors. Okay. And those vapors undergo so many changes when it reaches the sky. It forms clouds. And then because of the process of precipitation, it falls back. And when it falls back, it falls with a certain rhythm, with that pitter-patter sound. So the rain says that I'm the poem of the earth, because it is also made up of many beautiful aspects or elements. And the rain says, eternal I rise, impalpable out of the land and the bottomless sea. The rain keeps rising upwards without being seen by anyone. So this is evaporation. So here actually the poet wants to hint at the process of evaporation, and he doesn't use the word evaporation, but uses poetic sensibility. So for a poet, for a scientist, that is evaporation, but for the poet, it is rising of the water vapors without being seen by anyone else. So the nature keeps on doing its work without we, the human beings, being aware of what is happening with nature. So human beings remain oblivious of what is happening with nature, but nature keeps on doing its job. It keeps on rising upwards without human beings being able to see that. And the water keeps on rising upwards from the land or from the unfathomable seas. So the sea, which might have been which seems to be having no depth, like endlessly bottomless sea. So when the sea cannot be bottomless, there might be some end to the bottom of the sea. But bottomlessness is what? Exaggeration. So here the hyperbole, we can say, the poet has used. So the water keeps on rising upwards, maybe from the land. So on the land, there might be certain water bodies like rivers or then the sea. So river water keeps on rising from upward to heaven. So water goes from earth to heaven, where it gets vaguely formed. So where the water vapors change their form in a different way, altogether changed and yet the same. So in the sky, the water vapors change their form from vapors to clouds. So the vapors change into clouds, they form clouds. So the shape or the form of the water gets changed, because earlier they were vaporous, but there they became clouds. So the shape or the form gets changed, but in the end, it's their content is same. Okay, the water shape changes, but content remains the same. So here the poetic device is paradox. So paradoxically, the water bodies, the rains changes its form, but in a sense it's the same, because these might have been the vapors or it might have been the clouds. The content is water. So rain says that when it reaches the heaven, there it changes its shape, yet its content remains the same. So paradoxically, the content remains the same. So poetic device used over here is paradox, when some opposite is struck. I descend to lave the droughts. So finally, the rain, first the vapors went up, then their clouds were formed, then precipitation took place, and water started coming down in the form of shower, in the form of rain. And when it comes down, it washes the dry areas. Droughts are the dry land, dry earth. So when by the time the rain comes down on the earth, it starts quenching the thirst of the dry earth. It starts washing the very tiny particles on this earth, atomies, and it even starts cleansing the dusty layer of the globe. So wherever there is a dust, wherever there is, you know, dust on tiniest particles of the earth, the rain comes and washes them off. And all that in them without me were seeds only, latent unborn. So the rain comes and gives a new lease of life to the earth, because in the absence of the rain, the seeds would have remained seeds. The seeds would have remained hidden in the earth. But when the rain comes, those seeds start sprouting. Latent means hidden. Okay, unborn means they would remain the seeds. So the rain comes and gives birth to the, lets the seeds sprout up. And forever by day and night, I give back life to my own origin. So eternally, so the rain, which is an, you know, which is an eternal or a perennial process. So the life cycle of rain goes on, and it keeps on giving life back to its own origin. So the rain which gets life from the earth, it gives a new lease of life to the same earth when it comes back and make pure and beautify it. So how does it give life to the earth? It gives life to the earth by making it pure and by making it beautiful. So how does it purify the earth? By cleansing the dust particles. And how does it beautify it? By letting the seeds sprout and by letting the flowers bloom and by letting the trees get their greenery back. Okay, so it's with the rain that the earth becomes beautified. So here, up till here, it was a rain which was giving answer to what it was. Okay, so now there are two lines which are there in the bracket. So you people will be telling me, like, why are these two lines in brackets? Try to know. For song issuing from its birthplace, after fulfillment, wandering, wrecked or unwrecked, duly with love returns. Let me first explain, then you people try to find out, like, why have these lines been written in the brackets. For song issuing from its birthplace, after fulfillment, wandering, wrecked or unwrecked, duly with love returns. Wrecked or unwrecked means you pay attention to it or not, you notice it or not, you give heed to it or not, you observe it or not. The poet says, the song which takes its birth from the, which gets issued from its birthplace. So song, after getting originated from its birthplace, then it keeps wandering about for its fulfillment. and finally it comes back to its origin. Without, maybe it was given attention to or not, it comes back to its own origin. I'm repeating. In the last two lines, the poet says that the song takes its birth from its own origin. Okay, from where does this song come up, children? What is song? Song is, in the beginning, the poet says, the rain had told us that the rain is a poem of the earth. Rain said, I am poem of the earth. The rain called itself as the poem of the earth. And I told you, like, why does it call itself as the poem of the earth? Because poem is made up of beautiful thoughts, beautiful words, and rhyme and rhythm. Right? And now the poet says, song which gets its birth. Now the question is, from where, what is song? Song is also made up of beautiful words, beautiful thoughts, and then music. There is some music in the song. Okay? Not necessarily that there would be artificial instruments to accompany the song. The song, even if there is no musical instrument running behind the song, even then song will have its own musical quality, like a poem. So the song which gets issued from its place of birth, it keeps on wandering, it keeps moving all about the world, and finally it comes back to its own origin. Now let me explain. The song comes out of the heart. Okay, you can compose a song only when it comes in your heart. So this origin of the song is one's heart. Okay, you don't think about a song from your head, you think about a song from your heart. The words of a song come from the heart. Okay, and once a song is composed, it moves around the world. Means everybody listens to that song. So the people listen to that song. And finally, it comes back to its own place of origin. And finally, the song goes back to the place of its birth. So what was the place of the birth of the song? Heart. So out of the heart, a song comes and it goes back into the heart of the listeners. Okay? So the one who composed a song, of course he made it because he got sentimental about it. He felt that those words. But when we listen to the song, we also, some, if the song happens to be a very sad one, then the listeners also have the tears in their eyes, meaning the song reached their heart. Okay, if the song happens to be a happy one, then that song brings smile on the face of the listeners. Okay, and if the song happens to be a dancing number, then our feet start tapping to the beats of the song. So why does it happen? Because this, when the song which had come out of the heart of the composer, it goes back into the heart of the listener also. That's how the listener, they respond equally the way it might have come out of the heart of the composer. The song which takes its birth from the heart of the composer moves about, means reaches the listeners. And those listeners, they receive the song with all open heart and let it reside, let it go in their heart. So the song, it reaches the same place from where it had come, the way the rain had done. Right? So the last two lines have been written in brackets. Why have they been written in brackets? Because these two lines are not the continuation of the words as spoken by the rain. From the third line, I'm the poem of the earth, and make pure and beautify it, till there it was a rain which was speaking. But now these two lines, these are not the words of the rain. This is the observation, this is the, you can say, the thought process of the poet himself. It's the poet who speaks these words. Getting? It's a poet who speaks these words, who thinks about these things, and it is his own observation. So these two lines are poet's own observation or his own thought. So these last two lines are, you know, a break from the from what the rain was speaking. So this is not the dialogue of the rain, but poet's own observation or reflection, his own thought process. So they have been written in the bracket because they are not in continuation with the words of this of the rain. Is that clear? And one more thing, the voice of the rain, rain calls itself as a poem of the earth, and the poet compares the rain with the song. Okay, the way rain gets its origin from the earth and finally gives a new lease of life to the earth itself by coming back to it or by giving it back whatever it has got from it. In the similar way, song gets issued from the heart and goes back into the heart only. Okay, so or you can say like the song which takes its birth from the composer's heart comes back to him with the love which it had received from the listeners as well. Right? So with this, the poem has come to an end with a message that the nature, the cycle of nature, the process of nature is perennial and it goes on and on. So the nature goes on with its duties, with its responsibilities, and we the human beings need to be the same. We also need to go on and on with what we have, with whatever the kind of responsibilities we have been assigned with. Right? That's it.